Introducing Mike Tyson!
Mike Tyson turned pro in March 1985 and followed a frantic schedule that molded a teenage boy into the most exciting heavyweight the world had seen for a long time. 18 months later, he'd fought 24 times and won them all. All but two fights he had won by knockout, and 13 opponents were floored in the first round. Tyson's talent for first-round knockouts left a path of destruction, captivated the boxing world, and left crowds hungry for more. Before he'd even fought for the heavyweight title, he was compared to boxing greats such as Ali and Frazier. The eagerly anticipated 25th fight was a huge test for Tyson. His star opponent was Joe Frazier's son, Marvis, whose boxing record proved that he had the potential to follow in his father's footsteps. Marvis was considered the best American amateur heavyweight, having achieved 56 victories and only two losses. His professional record included wins over high-ranking boxers Joe Bugner and James Tillis, and out of 16 fights, he'd lost just once to former heavyweight champion Larry Holmes.
Jim Lampley live in Glens Falls, New York. Marvis Frazier, despite his 1983 one-round knockout loss to then-champion Larry Holmes, remains a marketable name in the heavyweight division. But here, the spotlight falls most directly on 20-year-old Mike Tyson, whose public appeal grows every time he fights. Here now is a quick update on what has happened with Tyson since his string of 19 straight knockouts ended with a 10-round decision over James Tillis on Wide World of Sports. Since last we saw Mike Tyson here on ABC Sports in May, he's added four more wins to his record. In his first fight after the Tillis decision, Mitch Green again took Mike the distance, but Tyson dominated throughout. And in his next fight against Reggie Gross in June, Mike showed the ability to take a punch, absorbing this uppercut before coming back seconds later to end the fight with a left hook. His knockout streak began anew and continued with a one-round dismantling of William Hosea, a 2-minute, 3-second fight. And in his last fight, Mike brought his win streak to 24 with a knockout of Lorenzo Boyd. A stiff uppercut ended matters in the second round. On his present schedule, Tyson fights more often than any other current boxer with status and marketability. Is it better to learn in the gym or in the ring? Boxing figures are divided.
I don't think he sufficiently has time to really get into the gym and learn. You can say, look, I can put him in with a stiff at each fight. And in the gym, I can bring in and pay good sparring partners with different styles, a runner, a slugger, a grabber, a holder, stuff like that, understand? But where has he really got the time for that there if you're fighting them every 2 weeks?
People today don't understand that the way human beings are structured, whether you fight or a brain surgeon or play the piano or throw rocks at a telephone pole, no matter what you're good at, if you do it once every 4 months, you're not going to be as good as if you do it once a week. It's the way human beings are structured.
The fighters Jacobs refers to include great featherweight champion Willie Pep, who fought 32 times in his first 16 months as a pro. Homicide Henry Armstrong, who once defended his welterweight title 5 times in 1 month. And Joe Lewis, who defended his heavyweight crown more than any other fighter in the division's history. Tyson believes the schedule the late Customato wanted for him is the one which will work best as he seeks the goal of winning the heavyweight crown.
It keeps my mind occupied on my business, and I'm not off my job much. I'm not out in the street. I'm not running around. I'm not hanging out with the guys as much and the girls. So my mind is preoccupied on my work, and it keeps me as sharp as possible. As many times as I fight, I become more immune to walking and being announced in front of a great deal of audience and everything. And as of now, it's becoming, like I say, an easy job. Like every day I'm used to coming in front of 10,000 people, 20,000 people, and like, hi, they're all my friends.
The late and legendary trainer Customato was the only real father figure Mike Tyson ever knew. Marvis Frazier's father, ever present in his life, is one of the most famous names in heavyweight boxing. It was called the fight of the century. March 8, 1971, Joe Frazier knocked down Muhammad Ali in the 15th round on his way to a unanimous decision to retain his heavyweight crown. Joe's long since retired and now trains fighters here in his own gym in Philadelphia. One of those, his own son, Marvis, who works alongside other members of the Frazier clan. Marvis has developed into a solid 210-pound professional fighter, adding 20 pounds onto the body which first came to public attention in 1979 when he became the junior world amateur heavyweight champion by stopping an Austrian fighter named Olaf Meyer. After only 10 pro fights, many felt Marvis was rushed into a shot at Larry Holmes. They were correct. Holmes stopped Marvis in the first round. But since that 1983 disaster, Marvis Frazier has rebounded with 6 straight victories, including decision wins over able opponents James Tillis, Jose Ribalta, and in his last fight in February over James Bone Crusher Smith. Though dropped in the middle of the fight, Marvis battled back against the larger Smith to capture the late rounds and a unanimous decision. Marvis is not the first famous heavyweight son to take the ring. There have been others with names like Fitzsimmons, Walcott, and Bear, all failures. But Marvis feels this union has proved beneficial in his case.
You have a father training you. There's that tense emotion that you're always trying to do best for your father. But then on the other hand, you know, you always have that encouragement to keep you going when times seem kind of hard for you.
Joe keeps a watchful eye on his son, as his father did for him back in Beaufort, South Carolina. It's a special responsibility.
That's a broad word, man. What did you say? Father. It's like, you know, there's a lot of daddies in the world today, but it's you very few fathers. I think fathers should take control of families, because that's one part of you. I mean, it was that lady and you brought this kid in this world. So how are you not going to be a father? How are you not going to be a good leader? I don't understand. I didn't come from that school.
It's a brutal business, but Marvis Frazier believes that working in it has kept this father and son close.
My father's my father. I can't change that. You know, I love him, he loves me. So that just makes it even better, you know? You have somebody that you really love and that you really care for in your corner.
And there is a live look at Marvis Frazier, who has just entered the ring here in the Glens Falls Civic Center. The record 16-1 with 7 knockouts. There are the vital statistics on the young man who is attempting to continue his father's legacy in the sport. Now entering the ring, the local favorite, trains and lives in Catskill, New York, has fought so many of his bouts here in the Albany, Troy, New York area. Mike Tyson entering as the Warrior, the characteristic no socks, no robe look. ABC Sports boxing expert, Alex Wallow. Alex, how do you see the fight?
Jim, in my opinion, it is not a matter of if Mike Tyson knocks out Marvis Frazier, but it's just a matter of when. I don't think Marvis is overmatched in this fight because of a lack of talent. Since being knocked out by Larry Holmes, he has reestablished himself as a heavyweight to be contended with wins, as we saw earlier, over the likes of Quick Tillis and Bone Crusher Smith. He can fight. The reason I and a lot of other people don't think he can win against Tyson is the fact that his style is made to order for Mike. Like his father, Marvis relies on pressure and stamina and intensity to beat an opponent, but that aggressiveness is just perfect for a bomber like Mike Tyson. Remember, as great as Joe Frazier was, when he faced a tremendous power man like George Foreman, he got bounced around the ring like a rubber ball. His pressure style was suicidal against Foreman, and I think that's the case here today with Marvis and Mike Tyson. As an amateur, Marvis did show ability as a boxer, and he does have that tremendous heart of a Frazier. And there are people who think that if Marvis can move and survive the early rounds, Mike Tyson will get tired and frustrated as he did against Quick Tillis. But Tyson is now confident in his ability to go 10 rounds that he saw against Mitch Queen. I don't see that as a problem.
All right, very quickly, let's look at the tail of the tape. You will see that Frazier has a reach advantage of about 6 inches, which will probably be nullified if he comes forward toward Tyson, as we expected. Round one is about to begin. The referee is Joe Cortez. In New York State, scoring is done by three judges. The referee does not score, scoring on the round system, supplemental four-point scoring system if the rounds wind up even, and the three knockdown rule is in effect. Tyson comes out slugging.
He comes out smoking like Marvis's father, Joe. Marvis must move or we're going to be out of here very, very quickly. Uppercut, and Marvis is hurt.
Frazier is down. Joe Cortez moves in to have a look, and he's going to stop the fight. It did not last 20 seconds. Tyson goes over to take a look at Marvis Frazier, obviously quite concerned. A terrific uppercut. The same punch with which Tyson knocked out Jesse Ferguson the first time you saw him here on ABC Sports.
Watch the uppercut, the right uppercut.
We're going to show it to you in just a moment. Right now, there is Jim Jacobs, yes.
Old manager Mike Tyson talking to him. 30-second knockout sensation. Watch the right hand of Mike Tyson. Marvis in the corner and trapped. There it was. Just clipped him right on the chin. The left was unnecessary. Marvis is badly hurt at this point. Uppercut again. And there, Marvis is out on his feet. Everything after this is just incidental.
The Frazier camp had expressed confidence before the bout. You wonder if they truly believed that Marvis could handle this kind of an attack.
You see that stiff left hand, that jab that Mike has not shown too much. The jab backed Marvis up into the corner. A second jab kept him there for those right uppercuts.
There will continue to be skepticism in some quarters regarding Tyson's stamina, his ability to take a punch, his technique in the ring. But with each succeeding bout, any skepticism about his punching power has to evaporate. And the good news is, I believe Marvis Frazier is standing up. There's a big crowd in that corner of the ring. Mike Tyson is going back over there now. We'll take another look live at what is happening in the ring after you finish seeing this third replay of the very quick knockout. As ring announcer Paul LaFleur announces the knockout, Mike Tyson gives his respects to Marvis Frazier.
Give me first your reaction to the fight.
The fight, I was confident. I trained real hard with my trainer, Kevin Rooney, who I owe a great deal to. And I came out and I was confident. I came out, I knew the fight. I felt it deep in my heart. I was going to stop him in the first round.
Did you know from watching tapes of him that you could hit him with the uppercut?
No, that's my favorite punch. And I watched the time, and I knew from my trainer telling me, as he throws his punches, he bends down. And I knew that would be perfect for my uppercut. I planned on working the body more, but I saw the opportunity, and it looked too good to go away.
You stuck him back in that corner with the jab, Mike. Is that jab going to become a big part of your repertoire as you go along?
Almost definitely. Me and my trainer have been working constantly and constantly on the jab. And as you say, I feel so confident, and I knew deep down in my blood that I was going to stop him in the first round.
You said that you feel fear before a fight. Did you have any fear for this fight, and how do you deal with that fear?
Well, I use the fear to reflect it on my opponent, because fear I use as my friend. It's my friend. If I don't have it, I don't fight.
In your mind, if your managers Jim Jacobs and Bill Caton and your trainer Kevin Rooney came to you and said, Mike, we think you're ready for a title shot tomorrow, would you agree with them at this point?
Most definitely. Anytime if my manager and my trainer feel that I'm confident and they're willing to put me in a title and they're sure I could beat the champion, I'm sure I could beat them also.
Of the three champions, who would you like to fight and why?
I'd fight anybody my trainer put me in with, because I'm confident I could beat any fighter in the world.
What do you think of the three champions?
They're all good fighters, because you have to be a good fighter. You can't take nothing away from them to become the champion. But I'm confident and I'm ready when my trainer tells me.
Good, Michael. Let's take a look at the replay of the knockout. We can almost play the entire fight in slow-mo. Here you're putting it back in the corner. There's the jab flicking out. Again, the jab. And here comes the uppercut.
Watch, look, everything's precise. I watch his hand come up. Watch him come down. As soon as he come down, boom! Look at that. Watch him come down. I knew he would come down.
Get ready to say boom again, Michael.
All right, boom. Look, and now look. Boom, come on. Boom, again. I'm going to hit him one more time. I like to hit him.
Missed with that one, I would have killed him.
What can I say? What can I say? That's all she wrote.
Missed with that one.
Kevin Rooney, Mike Tyson's trainer. What do you go back in the gym when he gives such a perfect performance? How can you tell him he's got to improve?
Well, I'm going to tell him that he could have went to the body a little bit more. You know, in 30 seconds, it's hard to get any criticism, but he could have worked the body a little bit more.
Tremendous uppercut. He looked sensational, Kevin. Congratulations to you.
Thank you very much. He's ready. He's ready to fight anybody in the world.
Let me talk to Jim Jacobs, the co-manager of Mike Tyson. Jim, first of all, quickly, is a Larry Holmes fight in the works as Mike's fight later this year?
Oh, most definitely. It's a fight that when we meet with Larry and his people, we're going to work out the terms and conditions.
That will be Tuesday of this week?
Well, in the middle of the week, we're going to meet with him, yes. And it's something that we will work out for the future. Absolutely.
Congratulations on a sensational showing by your fighter.
Well, thanks
Jim.
Much.
Now let's go back down to Jim Lampley at ringside.
Alex, the second defeat of Marvis Frazier's career. Both of them one-round knockouts, one at the hands of a man who was heavyweight champion at that time. Now this one at the hands of a man who many believe will soon be a heavyweight champion.
After this fight, Marvis Frazier fought three more times, winning them all. But those devastating 30 seconds with Tyson signaled the end of what should have been a successful career. He retired with a record of 19 wins and 2 losses to Larry Holmes and Mike Tyson, 2 of boxing's greatest. Marvis became an ordained minister and an active participant in prison fellowship.
Mike Tyson was exceptional, wasn't he? He's one of those who come along, he's brilliantly trained and managed. I don't mean that was why he was so great. He'd have probably been great if he was thrown in with anybody at any time. But on the other hand, he was well looked after and well taught, you know. I had some time for Tyson. His behavior at times could be questioned, I know, but not necessarily in the ring. I mean, he wasn't the cleanest fighter of all, but I mean, that doesn't mean anything. You know, you can be the cleanest fighter and you can't fight a lick, so you might as well be the roughest fighter and get away with it, which he did. You know, obviously we always liked watching Mike Tyson because you never knew what was going to happen with him. He was totally unpredictable, really, other than that sure he'll win, you know.
He hit guys and knocked them unconscious, not unlike Joe Louis and George Foreman. And he had hand speed like a Muhammad Ali, and he'd move around. He's going to be remembered for a long time.
Mike has an ability to slip punches that has not been seen in the heavyweight ranks or almost any other ranks since Muhammad Ali. It's been a long time since Muhammad Ali at his best when he was able to do that. In his later career, he wasn't able to. This is what he has. He's elusive, and he's a great, great, great boxer. People do not realize it. And that's what makes Mike Tyson so great and potentially one of the great fighters of all time.
Tyson was exceptional. To use the word animal might be a bit of disrespect, really, but he certainly was in the ring. I mean, he feared nothing and he did everything. If he could get away with it, he did.
You know, there's always the argument, oh, Tyson's the greatest, this and that. If I never fought him, you know, they would always say, oh, you never fought Tyson, but he would have beaten you anyway.
I believe he will be the youngest heavyweight champion of all time. And if he remains dedicated, interested, and without any distractions, I believe that eventually he'll go down in history as the greatest heavyweight champion we've ever had.
Watch me! Watch me! I got it! Watch me! I got it! Hey! I got something that makes me want to shout. I got something that tells me what it's all about. I got something. myself a few. I got soul, and I'm super bad.
In 1980, a reckless 14-year-old was introduced to boxing manager and trainer Cus D'Amato, who watched him fight and saw the next heavyweight champion of the world. From that moment, Mike Tyson dedicated his life to boxing. He turned pro in March 1985 and fought 15 times that year, winning all by knockout. His opponents often had stronger records, but he destroyed them all with shocking ease. Tyson's talent immediately demanded a bigger challenge, and in 1986, he progressed to higher-ranking opponents. When his path of destruction continued, the boxing world was hooked, and his effortless 30-second victory against Frazier sealed any doubts of his ability. In November 1986, two fights after Frazier, Tyson met Trevor Burbick and fought for the WBC heavyweight title. He knocked out Burbick in the second round and became the youngest heavyweight champion of the world at the age of 20. In 1987, he became the first heavyweight to own the WBA, WBC, and IBF title belts at the same time. Shortly afterwards, the cracks started to show, and his personal life began to cloud everything he had worked for. Jimmy Jacobs died in March 1988, and disputes with Bill Caton and Kevin Rooney eventually left Tyson on his own with Don King. This series tracked Tyson's first 25 fights, almost half of his total fights to date, all fought in the space of 18 months. Many of these fights were not televised, but they were crucial in shaping his career. This was Tyson when he was the most exciting up-and-coming heavyweight in the world. The Tyson when only boxing mattered. The Tyson who allowed us a glimpse at the once naive boy within. Tyson, raw and uncut, the true golden years.
Mike Tyson!
I believe he will be the youngest heavyweight champion of all time.